Hey, horse people. did a quick one on, my battery went dead on the other one, so I couldn't really get into it. But the horses could be in this shelter here, and instead they're way back out here, hanging out under a tree, just chilling out. Tell by the temperature gauge right here. Looks like we're in the 20s. A lot of people get a lot colder than we are. But, like I said, in the other video, as long as you keep horses, they've got their option of shelter. I got a heater in the water. I also have a little, this bucket out there. They sell these with heaters, those little buckets like that with heaters in them. That one doesn't have a heater. Some people call it a muck bucket. But what I'm doing is just bringing hot water from the house, and I pour it in over top of the ice, and then it makes the water semi-warm, and they seem to want to drink out of that. But again, I'm giving horses options. They have the option of drinking out of this water, or they can drink out of the big water trough with their where the heater's at. And the reason why I got this camera is Buddy was out there jumping around like there was something on the ground, and now they're both hanging out right there. So I was gonna go see if maybe there was a dead animal or something out there, because Buddy was sniffing and then he jumped back and buck and run, and Mr. T kind of walked off. So I'm not sure what's going on out there, but maybe I'll take a walk out there and see if there's anything. They just seem to be hanging out and smelling. I don't know if they're eating out there or not. I can't tell if you can see Mr. T's ice on him or not. Yeah, he's got some ice on his little crest there. Poor buddy. I'm waiting for the hate mail. Your horses have ice on them. You're a mean owner. Whatever. So, anyway. Little snow in Texas. And, like I said in the other video I wrote in the comments, I didn't get to say because my battery went dead. If you people in the winter areas like Norway, Sweden, Russia, Romania, I'm getting all these cold places, Canada, that are really cold. We don't get that cold here in Texas that much. So 20 degrees is kind of, you know, when it's really cold, you kind of plan for it. Your pipes are deeper. California, they bury pipes, you know, because it doesn't freeze much. Your water pipes are pretty shallow. In Texas, they're about a foot deep because it doesn't get that cold. So when it does get really cold, it creates problems that people aren't used to. Now, some people just leave their horses out there and say, you know what, they'll fend for themselves, they'll do all right. My thing is, I lock these horses up. They can't roam and free and be, you know, find their own shelter and find their own side of the hill or run in the stream or whatever. So it's my job. Mr. T just told Buddy, get out of the way. But he's like, dude, see, that's what he's doing earlier. Now, horses, when they're out there doing this, they're warming themselves up. Now, I did have somebody say that they think, for some reason, this thing doesn't seem like it's focusing. I'm going to shut this down for a second and then open it back up, see if it focuses a little better. Some people will say that when a horse shivers, they're intentionally shaking their muscles to generate heat, much like a person would do if we stomp our feet or if we walk around, we get cold, we start moving. Some people believe that when horses shiver because they can shake a fly off them with their muscles, they're intentionally doing that to heat up those muscles and create heat. I don't know if I believe that, because when I shiver, I'm cold and I can't control it, but I'm not a horse. So, you know, there's that variance there on who's right, what's going on. Well, I wish I could see underneath that tree on what they were doing, and I don't think I can. I'm going to try to lower this down a little bit. Can anyone else see what they're doing on that tree? Are they just, oh, they're kissing and hugging. Oh, they need a little blankie on and their little tail braided, because they're my little humans. Look, I don't like to personalize horses and make them to Buddy's crowd. Miss T, Miss T's like, get back. Buddy's like, let's play. Miss T's like, dude, don't make me tie a knot in your butt. But sometimes a lead stallion will run a herd. They will move a herd when it gets really cold. They won't let the herd stand around. So, look, these guys look like they got little white noses. I can't really tell. They're such good boys. They're like looking at me like, he thinks we don't know we're filming, dummy. So I don't know when a horse shivers if that's true or not. If there's a vet or somebody else has heard that, go ahead and put it in the comments. If you people in cold areas have, you know, suggestions on tricks, some other tricks that people keep their water warm is they built a little plywood wood enclosure for the water bucket, and they throw horse manure around the water bucket. Because manure, you know, horse poop kind of turns into fertilizer and it creates heat and it will warm up. So people that don't have anything else to keep their water warm, if you build a box, a wooden box around your water trough, and then fill that open area with either straw, hay, or horse poop, that will insulate and keep your water troughs from freezing, or at least freezing as hard. Now, that's some of the things that I've read for you know, cold water tips. Whether that's true or not is up to you. I know the straw works. I would assume horse poop works. Actually, anything works that creates a barrier for the cold. I mean, cold has to get to something for it to freeze. If cold can't get to it or is impeded, or if it has to heat up several inches of something before it gets through, it has to be colder to freeze. So those are some of the tips. Of course, I asked, you know, the really cold places that are in the negative 20s for months, I'm like, wow, how do you keep your water from freezing? They go, we got heaters. Now, what happens if you don't have electricity? Well, then you're going to need to, you know, use manure. One guy, which I thought was a pretty good idea, he buried his water trough halfway in the ground or three quarters in the way ground. So he created an earth barrier around his water trough, which created insulation. Some people will wrap it in insulation and then wrap it in chicken wire. You know, putting a mat underneath it, keeping it out of the wind. Any type of shelter over your water helps the water not freeze as quick. I put two buckets out there, one out in the open and one underneath the shed, and the one in the open froze quicker and harder than the one under the shed. Now again, over time, several days, we're not supposed to get above freezing for the next 3 or 4 days. So that's why I filled up too. Buddy's about to get a spanking. Mr. T's like, you damn. But you know what? Mr. T could leave if he wanted to. Now, you notice they're under that tree out there. That's good job, Mr. T. Get him. Wow, what a classic moment. Okay, what you just saw there was in wild stallion, or when stallions, an experienced stallion will always take out a horse's knee. When a youngster comes up and challenges an older experienced stallion, the older horse will usually just bend down, take the knee out immediately. And that's why it's a natural thing when you're trying to teach a horse to bow. If you poke or squeeze or mess with the knee, a horse's natural instinct is to pull those legs back and they drop to their knees. So teaching a horse to bow or getting on his knees, you're basically using this natural instinct of when horses create dominance, they go for the knees. They want to drop the other horse to his knees. Once they drop that horse, they get on top of him and show dominance. They can grab him on the back of the neck. They can literally, I've seen Mr. T pin a horse. Buddy's filling his oats. I've seen Mr. T pin a horse, take him to his knees, and then just lay his neck over him, and then he'll let his legs go, and he'll literally hold the horse down so the horse can't get back up on his front legs. Now, you want to show dominance, that's pretty much dominance. That pretty much teaches the horse on the ground, if you mess with me, I'm going to pin your ass to the ground, you're not going to move. Now, of course, the people on horse forum or the barn witches will be, that's mean, and you should never treat a horse, and whatever, big dummies. So that's what you just saw there was a classic example of a smart older horse, Mr. T. He let Buddy bug him. He let Buddy do some things. He let him push his buttons, and then when he said he had enough, he bit him. He backed him up. Then he went for his leg. When he went for his leg, Buddy kind of dropped his front end, and then you saw Mr. T immediately spin that butt around. And Mr. T's classical at this, man. When he wants to teach a stallion trying to take one of his mares a lesson, he can spin that butt around in a second, man. And I mean, he's just ready to back it up. And you saw him back up pretty quick and really move aggressively toward Buddy. And that basically was teaching Buddy a lesson. Dude, you mess with me, I'm going to teach you a lesson. And it's going to be a hard lesson. You notice Mr. T didn't say, Buddy, I've got a carrot in the shelter. Would you leave me alone? Let me go get you a carrot. Buddy, if I brush you, will you leave me alone? Buddy, if I braid your mane and tail, will you leave me alone? Mr. T didn't do any of that. Mr. T said, I've taken it. I pinned my ears. He kind of showed his head a few times. Buddy didn't get the message. Then he went after his leg, his neck. He went for the bite. As soon as he got Buddy backing up a little bit, he'd spin that butt around. He just backed up into him. Now, you notice he didn't have to kick him. He didn't have to hurt him. He didn't get mean, and it wasn't personal. He merely showed Buddy a lesson pretty quick, and it was over. People need to get that with horses more than anything else, is it's not personal. When we get mad, when we get upset, when we get angry, when we react, when our ego gets involved, when people are watching and we feel embarrassed, all those things make it personal to us, and it's never personal for the horse unless we make it personal. That was not personal. Buddy and Mr. T, that's why when people tell me, well, if you correct your horse won't love you. You don't think these two horses love each other? These horses are buddies. They depend on each other. Their survival, their warmth, their care, everything depends on each other. Which is why I would never separate them and lock them up because they don't listen to me and they want to hang out together. Those are the craziest selfish things that I hear. When people want to lock a horse up because he won't come when I call him. Because he gets too attached to other horses. I don't want him to be Buddy sour. He won't love me as much. He starts liking Mr. T more than he likes me, so I'm going to lock Buddy up. Mr. T likes Buddy more than... Of course they like each other more than me. They're freaking horses and I'm not. Horses like other horses. So don't try to compete with another horse for affection. Just be part of the herd. Be a good leader. Be fair. Don't make it personal. Be clear. Mr. T was very clear in that great captured moment of correcting Buddy. There was no guessing. Buddy wasn't like, gee, I wonder what he wants. Buddy wasn't like trying a bunch of wrong options like, well, maybe if I do this. Buddy was like, oh, hell no, I know exactly. He wants me to back up or I'm about to get my butt kicked. And Buddy got the hell out of there. Mr. T was clear. He was precise. He was quick. It was over. It wasn't personal. All those lessons people need to learn when you're working with horses. I got off my topic of winter cold, but that was a great moment. And as usual, Mr. T is such a great teacher. All horses are. Buddy was a teacher by showing us how he can understand when it's clearly communicated. He understands that he's very forgiving. He's standing next to Mr. T. They understand that it's not personal. It's merely a hierarchy and a pecking order. And if you push with the big dog, then you're going to get pushed back. And you're going to get pushed back harder, and you're not going to like it. Buddy didn't like moving away. Buddy didn't like getting his leg bit. Buddy didn't like having that butt shammed in him. He didn't really dislike it because I think he plays and he likes to mess around. So it was still playful for Buddy, but Mr. T was much more serious about it. But when it was over, it's over. There's no hard feelings. Buddy's not hanging on to a grudge. Mr. T's not giving him extra carrots and blankets and extra food later because he had to correct him. It just is what it is. And when people start seeing that in horses, they're going to understand horses better and their relationship's going to get better. All right? Well, hell, I got a little long-winded here. I was just going to make a quick one about the water and the cold weather, but Mr. T, Buddy, wanted to give us a great lesson. So thanks, boys. And we'll end that there. Buddy, Mr. T, you're good boys! They can't hear me. All right, we'll end that there.